Good morning, ladies, and welcome to a really exciting adventure. My name is Jamie and I have Jandre, who's sitting on the back with me, and he's going to be pointing the camera in different directions and showing you all of the magical things that we have out here. Now, 8 years ago, I was sitting exactly where you are. I was in Matric at Rodine, and I was sitting in the uniform, everything like that. I know that auditorium like the back of my hand, and it's so wonderful that you can join us. This is live, so what you're seeing on your screen right now is happening in real life, 600 kilometers away from where you are now. Now, how many of you have been on safari before? How many of you have been to the Kruger? That's where we are now. We're in the Sabi Sands, so we're connected to a huge area of wildlife where the animals have been roaming free for years and years, longer than our grandparents have been alive. And what an incredible experience. We have so much to show you and so much to teach you, but I also want to hear from you. So guys, please send through your questions. Get your teachers to email them through. Now, I'm not sure how this magic technology works, but I think I have the best job in the world. I get to take a game drive with a man sitting on the back operating a camera. It boosts the signal all the way up into the sky and then bounces back through satellites right across to where you're sitting now. I want you to just imagine for 1 minute. Just close your eyes. Imagine you can feel the breeze blowing on your face. It's very windy. It's cold today. Imagine you can smell that earth. It's damp, it's fresh, we've had a lot of rain. Finally, the animals have been so thirsty and we've got things to find. Now, we can see lions out here, we could see elephants, we could see leopards. We just don't know what we're going to see. Now, last night, I know there was a leopard somewhere on here. And Mia, you might recognize this. Mia, if you're watching, we're on quarantine clearings and we're going to do a big loop around and see what we can find. Okay, let's go. Are you imagining that you're on the back of the vehicle with me? So everybody has to stay seated. You've got to keep your arms and your legs inside. You've got to watch your head for thorn trees. But most importantly, I need your help. I need you to watch what's happening around me and see what you can spot. See if you can spot something before I do. So special about that. It's not just the big animals, it's the little animals, the little insects that are... Oh, there we go. I found one for you. I'll try and shift back so that Jandre can show you what I'm looking at. Jandre had a bit of a tilt. There we go. Now, some of you must have seen these before. Look at the way its little legs go. They move like waves. What do you think that might be? You might know it as a shongololo. That's what I was always taught. And they were one of my favorite things to go and pick up when I was a kid. You know how they curl up tight, tight into a ball? Now, I'm not going to do that to him because I don't want to scare him. He's only just popped out because it's been raining. I can imagine that it would be very, very scary to have a hand suddenly reach down and pluck him off the ground. You can see his little feelers moving. Now, those little bits that are sticking out in the front of his head, using them to tell him where to go. And all those hundreds of little legs moving in waves. And they're very safe creatures. They can't bite, they don't sting, they're completely harmless. Shongololo. Now, how many of you find bugs gross? Because you mustn't find bugs gross. Bugs are cool. There's so many different ones out here and they all play a really important part in the world out here. If we didn't have bugs, none of the animals out here, none of the trees out here would survive. Even the trees need certain types of bugs so that they can make more baby trees. Okay, should we leave our little millipede to go about his business and see what else we can find? Oh, so exciting. Now, when I was a kid, one of my favorite things to do was when I went on holiday with my grandfather, we'd get up really, really early. It was the only time I was allowed a bit of coffee. and it was coffee with lots and lots of condensed milk. And we go out when it was still dark, and we go drive around the Kruger Park. And I still remember that excitement of just never knowing what exactly it was we were going to see. And I remember it being incredibly intense. Now, my favorite thing about being out here is that no matter how much I learn and how many books I read, and I come out with a whole library whenever I go out on a drive. I take my bird book, I take my reptiles book and my frog book, books on trees, books on grasses, all of that comes with me. And no matter how much I learn and no matter how much I read about, I'm never ever going to know everything that's out here. And for me, that is one of the most incredible things. So many different answers as to what it is you guys want to see. I know, Emma, you wanted to see a wild dog. I want to see wild dogs all the time. They're one of my favorite things out here. Olivia, you wanted to see a leopard. Well, Olivia, there's a good chance we might. I know she was around before. What I've just spotted. Olivia, I promise you I'm also looking for leopards. You've got to look hard though, because they're difficult to see. Now, isn't this sweet? Now, for those of you who don't know birds, these are called Warburg's eagles. And these two are really, really special because they're pale. Most Warburgs are brown in color. These have got white chests. This is a male and a female. The female's on the right, she's bigger, so she can boss her husband around. One of the best things about these birds is they mate for life, and they fly thousands of kilometers every year, but they always stay together. And if we look slightly to the right, you'll see what these two have come back for. They do it every year. Imagine flying 1,000 kilometers and coming back to the exact same place. You see that messy bundle of sticks there? Somewhere in there is a baby Warburg's. Probably still in its egg. I haven't seen any movement yet. There's going to be a little baby chicken there, maybe even two. And what a lucky little bird it is. It's got two fabulous parents to look after it and keep it well fed. You can see them ruffling. Their feathers are being ruffled. They're cold. I'm going to tuck themselves against each other and try and stay warm. They don't want to be out flying and hunting now. It's too windy for them. I'm going to settle on the tree and wait for the wind to die down. Beautiful birds. As we drive along and see what we can find. Emma, I just wanted to tell you that we have had in the last few, probably about the last week, we have had some of the most amazing wild dogs I have ever seen. We've got two packs that move around here. One is called the Investec Pack, and it's got 3 adults and 11 puppies, and they are the cutest things in the world. They've got these huge ears that look too big for their bodies. And then we've got another pack known as the Sands Pack, and that's got 21 dogs in it. And those two have been moving backwards and forwards on Djuma, which is where we are now. And they've been chased. We've seen them being chased by elephants. We've seen them chasing hyenas. It's been incredible. I think they are probably my second favorite, if I had to choose, my second favorite predator out here. My top favorite predator is spotted hyenas. I love hyenas. Go. So Sienna, you wanted to see a hyena. I always want to see hyena. Did you know, Sienna, that spotted hyenas are probably the smartest animals out here? Now the light's a bit cloudy, so it's going to be difficult for Jandre to show us, but I've just spotted some footprints. I want to see. We're going to track this animal. We're going to see if we can find it. Now it's slipped in the mud. You can even see where it's slid around. The car's going to wobble a bit as I take my foot off the brake, but look at that track. And I'm going to jump out for a second. I'm just going to show you how many toes it has, and then I want to hear from you. I want to hear guesses. Let's see if you guys can tell me what you think this is. Now, it's perfectly safe for me to jump out. I've double-checked the area. I've made sure there's no animals, and I'm very close to the car. I'm going to just show you quickly what I'm looking at. Now, if you look down here, something big has walked along this road. And I want to see if you guys can guess what it is. It's got four toes. There's four toes here as well. There's one, two, three, four. And they're pointing that way. Imagine your feet. Imagine your toes. It's showing us which direction. Now, it's a big animal. Imagine I was large. Its feet are wide apart. And it's walking this way. And I think we should go and see if we can find it and figure out exactly what it might be. But I want to see if you guys can guess what it might be. Something that comes out at night. So this animal was walking down the road sometime last night. And I think we should see if we can figure it out. Four toes, big feet, and big feet that are wide apart. Now, one of my first things that I learned when I was training to do this job was to read the signs. Now, the bush tells you a story. Even if you don't see the animal, the bush is going to show you what happened. It's going to tell you the story. You just have to, it's like learning to read. You have to learn to read the signs and the messages that it's trying to tell you. This animal is still walking slowly up the road. You can imagine it like being a detective. Now, Marungawa, you were wondering why the Shungalolo has so many legs. Remember that little bug that we saw that was, its legs were moving in waves? I have to be honest with you, I'm not sure. I don't know why it has to have so many legs. Maybe because it allows it to move in a way, because of the way that it climbs up things. Having so many little legs means it can grip and move over twigs and logs and move around. Now, it doesn't eat meat, it eats vegetables, so it will only eat plants out here. Maybe having that many legs to grip onto branches means that it can get up and grab the best looking, the best juiciest leaves. Our animal is still coming along this road. I think he's here somewhere. Oh, I think we've spotted it. I think I can see the animal. Have you guessed what it is yet? I'm going to duck my head down so Jandre can show you. Can you see that eye sticking up there? I think we've tracked our first animal. Now, I may or may not have cheated a little bit, because I know this hippo. His name is Peter, and his name is Peter because he lives in a pan. So that little area of water, that's known as a pan in the bush. And I'm going to tell you Peter's story in a moment. Let's see if we can sneak up a little bit closer without scaring him. I don't want to make him frightened. I don't want to make him have to get up. Remember that this is their home. We're visitors in their house. So it's always really important that everything you do out here, you do with respect. You wouldn't go into somebody else's home and invade their personal space. You've got to be very respectful when you approach animals. It's also important to remember that they are big and they can be dangerous. But he's lost. Peter is quite peaceful and at rest at the moment. I'm animal, so always on the lookout. Isabella, you wanted to see a crocodile. And of course, I'm sure you've seen lots of documentaries where you see hippos and crocodiles sharing the same water. I don't see one in here today, but that doesn't mean there isn't one. He could be hiding. And crocodiles are amazing. They seem to come out of nowhere. They can walk long, long distances. You wouldn't think it because they swim so much. Oh, look how sleepy Peter is. I'll tell you the story behind Peter. We've only just had lots of rain that has come through in the last 2 days. But before that, it was 40 degrees every single day and there was not a drop of rain. So the dams are getting smaller and smaller, the rivers are getting smaller and smaller, and it puts hippos like Peter under pressure because they don't have as much space. So for an old boy like this, he probably got into a fight with one of the other younger males, and he decided that he didn't want to stick around and get bullied anymore, and so he found himself his own personal space. Now here's something amazing about Peter that I'm not sure if you all knew. Hippos are one of the only animals that can't swim. And I promise you, I'm not lying to you. Peter cannot swim. He's lying on the bottom of the, on the mud at the bottom of the dam. And what hippos do is they can actually control how much they float or sink. So if they want to, in a deep dam, they can sink down to the bottom and then bob back up. They can push up with their legs or they can walk along the bottom of the dam. And that's how they move in this area. Done. Lungi and Hannah, fantastic. Apparently you guessed that it was a hippo. So it was Lungi and Hannah as well as Savannah. Really well done, guys. I'm very impressed. I thought I was going to catch you out with that one, but obviously not, because you figured out it was a hippo and we followed his tracks. Just like I said, following clues, like animals leaving evidence for you to follow so you can figure out where they've gone or what they were. I'm very impressed that you managed to figure it out and figure out the fact that it was Peter. Now I'm not sure about you, but I think we should continue our search. I really have a strong feeling that we might be finding a leopard. Other guides did see her this morning. Reverse backwards, do another loop around Peter and head off. And while I do that, Malaika, it's like you read my mind. It was something I meant to mention and I forgot. Malaika, you wanted to know what you should bring if you go into the wild. Oh, can you hear the wind? You can see how my hair is going to be impossible to brush out. Now, Malaika, you wanted to know what you bring. I'll show you a couple of important things. First of all, oh, it's heavy. Is a backpack. Some kind of bag that you can carry stuff in. And then, as I mentioned earlier, a hat is very important. A radio is very important because you don't always have cell phone signal out here, so it's important that you're able to communicate. Then I've got my library collection, I've got my books. I'll stop for one moment so I can get into my bag and show you what else I've got. Very important, probably the thing that I use the most out here, binoculars to help me look at all of the birds and everything that we see outside. Now mine are getting a bit old. This is stuck. A little bit of sand, a little bit of damage, but still my most trusted tool. Then I have a Leatherman, which is a multi knife. Jigger's making a very funny noise. Figure out where that is coming from. Oh, I know what I did. I turned the windscreen wipers on. Obviously, Jigger doesn't have a windscreen anymore, but once upon a time she did, and I always refer to the car by its name. And it's got the device that still works. Now, Nina, we're just leaving the hippopotamus, Peter in the pan. and you wanted to know how much does a hippopotamus weigh. And the answer is somewhere in the region of 2,000 kilograms, so 2 tons. Now, Peter's a huge hippo. He might be even bigger than that. And the best and most amazing thing about that is the fact that although they look big and fat and slow, a hippo could easily run faster than any of us. Definitely could run faster than me. I was never very fast at school, but they still can run. Still run incredibly quickly. Apparently, Emma's dad was chased by a hippo when he was a little boy, and that could be incredibly scary. Now, hippo, although they only eat grass and they go and feed on the vegetation, they can be quite scary animals, and sometimes they get a bit cross. If they're out of the water, because they feel safe in the water, when they're on land, they get uncomfortable, they feel a bit scared, and that makes them a little bit cross. And sometimes they do chase people. So it's important to remember that they are wild animals and they can be dangerous, and they're always going to be faster than you think they are. People driving their guests around, and this allows me to talk to them and communicate with them. I just want to go on now and just double check with them what's happening. Stations with gorilla coming. Apparently they don't want to talk to me today. That's fine. We'll find the leopard. She was here somewhere. Now let's see if we can spot her. Where do you think a leopard's going to be hiding? I think a good place to start is somewhere in the trees. Now, Olivia, the reason I'm looking for a leopard, and I know you really wanted to see one, is first of all because I love them and I think they're amazing creatures, but also because I know that there was a leopard around here last night. I know she was moving through. Let's check the trees as we go past. She might be lying somewhere here. Keep your eyes peeled. Now remember, leopards are really well camouflaged. You've got to look carefully. They've got those incredible spots that hide them away. I'm going to stop for a moment because I've spotted, it's not a leopard, but I've spotted some very pretty birds and they're making a lot of noise. Switch off so you can hear it. That's amazing! Lilac-breasted rollers are chasing a hoopoe for no apparent reason. That's so cool. Can hear them shouting angrily. Shift back to see if you can see it again. John Ray did an amazing job of staying with that lilac-breasted roller. Now I'm sure you guys have seen them before. They're beautiful birds with that bright colouring. Incredible looking. He's ducked away now. Now the reason that the lilac-breasted rollers, it's a type of bird, were chasing the hoopoe, and I'm sure many of you have seen hoopoes in your garden, is because right now they're breeding and they all have secret nest sites around the reserve, and one of their favorite nest sites is to be in a hole in a marula tree. And I think that lilac-breasted roller was just playing it safe and chasing it away. Now, let's head across. She was somewhere on this clearing. I'm sure she's here. Let's double check. Now remember, as I said, they were very well camouflaged. But there's one tip, there's one part of a leopard that sometimes gives them away. And that is that white tip of the tail. Maybe that's what we should be looking for. It could be hanging out of a tree, could be hiding under a bush. And while we're checking the trees, Georgina and Kada, you were wondering why leopards hide in trees. Now I have a secret to tell you. Leopards are actually quite scared of the other animals that are out here. So not necessarily prey, they do get very nervous. So things like hyena, wild dog, lions, they will all chase a leopard if they can. I think we should go this way. For leopards, because they're so good at climbing, there's no other animal that can catch them up in a tree. Oh, I've spotted our first clue. Now guys, this is a sad fact of nature, but leopards have to eat, and I think we've found our clue here. Now this is one thing that leopards are famous for doing. They put their breakfast and their dinner in tree branches. Now there's an impala up a tree, which means our leopard is somewhere here. Let's see if we can figure out where she is. I know it's very sad to see. Very difficult to see. But just bear in mind that there are lots of impala and leopards are built to eat them. By hiding her food up in the tree, it means that the hyenas can't steal it. Anything will try and steal it from her. Lions will try and steal it. And she's put so much time and energy into catching it. And she's got a huge responsibility. She's got to feed herself all by herself. Where could she be? She must be here somewhere. She's not in the tree with the impala. Let's see if we can spot her. I think I see something. Can you guys see the leopard? She's hiding from us. Have you spotted her yet? Can you see her now? There, she's moving her head and she's lying down. All you can see is just the tip of the spots behind. What I'm going to do is I'm going to shift around and you can get a chance to see her properly. How exciting is this? We found our leopard, we followed the clues. We've seen she's hidden her breakfast away in a tree. Ellen, you were wondering if leopards are the best climbers since we were looking for her in a tree. Sorry, Erin, you were wondering if they're the best climbers. Yes, absolutely. They are perfectly graceful and balanced. I don't know how they do it because I fall out of most of the trees I try and climb. But leopards just have a way of doing it. They've got those perfect claws and muscles to hold them up and climb into the trees. Now I've seen lions climb trees and they can climb, but they look very silly doing it and they fall out all the time. It's very funny to watch. And they generally don't do it, which is great for the leopards because it means the leopard, if a lion comes, can race up a tree and hide away from it. Let's see if we can find a nice place to view her. And Mia, I think you're right. I think you're on to me. It was Karula that killed the impala and she's here. I'm just trying to find us a nice place to see her without disturbing any of the other people who are out on drive as well. Let's see if I can. When we got a nice view of her, I'm gonna tell you a bit of a story about the leopard you're going to see. Now we're going to have to content ourselves with this view. She's very hidden away. Sorry, Jandre, I put you on quite a slope. Here you go. A very sleepy, very well hidden Karula. Now, for those of you who don't know, I'm sure Mia does, Karula is the queen of Djuma, which is where we are now. She's 11 years old, and this entire area is her territory. And next door to her are all her daughters that she's had over the years. She's been an incredible mother. She's an incredible hunter. And a very brave and courageous leopard. Now for a leopard that lives all by herself. Looking after herself all alone when she has cubs. And the wonderful news is that she may actually be pregnant right now. She was mating with a male just a few weeks ago. Now, it's too soon for us to tell, but she could be pregnant and we might be expecting cubs in about 3 months' time. Now, she was out on this clearing hunting. She's exhausted from all of the hunting that she's done. And I know that, Julia, you were wondering how fast can a leopard run? The answer, Julia, is very, very fast. Now imagine the distance from one side of the auditorium to the other. Now count 2 seconds in your head. One, two. That leopard could have run from one side to the other in that space of time. So essentially they can cover 22 meters in 1 second. Isn't that crazy? Now they can't do it forever though. Now Jordan, it's a difficult one. You wanted to know how you tell if it's a male or a female. What tells me it's a female at this point is the size of her and the fact that I know she was in this area last night. So she, as a full-grown female, is about half the size of an adult male leopard. So that's really the only difference, is that their size. Males are much bigger. They've got big, thick, strong necks to protect them, and they've got what's known as a dewlap, so a flap of skin in the front that protects them. And the other way that you can tell is the obvious way. They have differences, and the males have testicles underneath their tails that you'll be able to see, but only, of course, if you can see under their tail. I'm not going to go and ask her to lift up her tail, though. Now, what I really want to do, now that the other vehicle has moved around, is I'm going to try and shift so you can see her face, and you can have a look at the face of the Queen of Djuma. She's a very sleepy leopard though. How amazing is this? We got our leopard. Now she was very tricky to spot and we had to look hard for her. And I know that, Savannah, you were wondering why leopards are as camouflaged as they are. Why are they so difficult to spot? And the answer is because there's so many animals out here that are a threat to them. They can hide away from things like lions, but most importantly, they hunt all by themselves. They're not like lions that, or wild dogs or spotted hyenas that can chase prey and then get to it and have one group member go around. They can ambush. It doesn't quite work like that with leopards. They've got to use stealth. What they do is they go and they sneak and they hide away in the grass and they wait for the prey to move past and then they pounce. Again, as I said, 22 meters in 1 second. There we go, we can get a little bit closer now without disturbing anybody else. Good morning, Karula. Hello, big girl. You're sleepy. Very clever. Did you catch that impala all by yourself? Now, I have a secret. I always talk to animals. And, hey. All right, girl. Okay, girl. Now, you don't need to be worried. She was perfectly relaxed. She just got a bit of a fright. Okay, girl. All right, girl. I'll back up. What I'm going to do is give her a bit of space. She's sending me a message, but how incredible was that? Teeth out, you can just see why they're such fearsome predators. Here we go. Stop here and let her relax a bit. Okay, big girl. Did you get cross there? Now what could have happened as well is that she was fast asleep and she woke up and saw us there and decided actually she didn't like that. But there you go, look how beautiful she is. And a wild creature out here. And as I said, it's very important to approach them with complete respect. So when she gave me that message to say, hey, I'm cross with you, move away, we moved away immediately. And animals tell you what they're thinking, they tell you how they're feeling. Oh, the one magical, oh, look how round that belly is. She's had a big breakfast. The one magical thing about Karula, who's now settled down completely, but she's hidden her face from us, is she's got the word wow on her forehead. Yes, please look here, girl. See if you can spot it. It's right between her eyes. And it says wow. It took me a long time to be able to see it, but as she's looking at us, there you go. See, she's perfectly calm and relaxed now. She's lying down. And she's going to probably go back to sleep with such a full belly. She's been feeding on that impala probably all night. And Zizi, you were wondering, how do leopards get their prey up into trees? The answer is they are incredibly strong. Imagine you were carrying something that weighs the same amount as you do in your mouth, and then you have to climb trees using your claws. They're much, much stronger than we are. Now, she probably weighs somewhere in the region of about 45 kilograms. She's quite a small leopard. All right, girl. I'm moving slowly. And she's still strong enough to lift an impala that weighs about 50 kilograms up into the tree. They're incredibly strong creatures. So she'll grab it in her mouth and then pull herself up. Now she's left her breakfast up in the tree, and that is because if we look at that incredibly round belly, she's full. So Deanne, you were wondering why she's left it. The truth is she's stuffed. She just cannot eat anymore. She cannot face eating anymore. She's so full of food, she's just gonna wait a little bit. And that's why she's pulled her food. You can almost think of it like leaving your leftovers in a Tupperware in the fridge for the next day. That's what she's done. That's why she's put that kill in the tree, so that she can keep her food safe from a hyena. Now, we've got lots of hyenas that live all around us, and she knows that because she's clever. Karula's had 11 years to learn. She's got to put her food up in her tree, up in the trees. Now, I've met her daughter, Shadow. And Shadow, for some reason, Shadow was one of Karula's first cubs, and she's now 9 years old. And for some reason, Shadow is just not as good as her mom at putting food up in trees. She always, always has her kills stolen by hyena because she doesn't take them up into a tree. And it just goes to show you that each and every one of these animals is completely unique. What I'm going to do now that she's relaxed is I'm going to move a little bit further away from her. She's actually moved closer to us, but I'm going to give her a bit more space now that she's settled down. Apparently, let's shift a bit further back. There we go. That's much better. Just giving her a chance to relax and calm down a little bit. Have a nice view of her as well. Now, I know that Madame Gonzales, you were wondering where we are in the park. We're actually technically in the Sabi Sands, so the closest gate to us is around Orpen Gate. That's the entrance to the Kruger Park. And we're just on the boundary. So the Sabi Sands sits on the western boundary of the Kruger National Park, but it has no fences in between it. We're just south of Orpen on the western edge of Kruger Park. And maybe you can get your teachers to show you where you are on the map. Well, it's been an absolutely wonderful morning to have shared with you all. And I want to say a big thank you. Remember, guys, this is your home, this whole place, and learn as much about it as you can. because one day it will be up to you to come and enjoy and protect these beautiful animals. Have a wonderful day, and I will possibly see you next time. Bye-bye, guys.